in the last class, we discussed about stages in product development, right? What are the three stages we discussed? What are the three stages of product development? Or four stages, right? How many stages? Three or four? Three stages of product development. What are they? Understand the opportunity, develop a concept, implement a concept. And then each one we went through, understand the opportunity. What do we do in that stage? What is the purpose of the stage? Understand the opportunity. See whether there is a good potential to develop a product and sell it in the market, right? And there are four steps involved in understanding the opportunity, right? What are they? Develop a vision, market opportunity, customer need analysis, and competitive analysis, right? So at the end of all these, you will be able to understand whether there is a real opportunity to develop a new product. And then next stage, develop a concept, right? So develop a concept, what we do? We decide what the product should do and how the product should provide the functions needed in the product. That is basically the develop a concept. And the last one is implement a concept, right? Where actually we try to build the prototype, test it, do some trial runs, and then sell it in the market. So these are the three important stages in developing a product. Okay, so these are the three stages in developing a product. So we have develop a vision, market opportunity analysis. So this actually forms the understand the opportunity. This forms the develop a concept, and this forms the implementing a concept. So these are the three important stages in designing a new product, and we'll be looking at these two stages, the understand the opportunity and develop a concept. So these are the two stages we'll be looking into the detail. So let us see some of the companies, how they actually develop the products. So this actually shows the product development process of a company, which is the Xerox Corporation. What do they make? Xerox, what do they make? Photocopying machines, right? How many people say, I want to photocopy? Or how many say, I want to Xerox? I want to Xerox this paper, right? So Xerox has become synonymous with photocopy. So they are very highly successful in developing products for photocopy. So how do they actually develop the products? So they do a product vision. So they have a vision for a new product, and then they define how do they approach the market. That is basically market opportunity analysis and market and plan and technology. And then they go for the concept development, that is define product and deliver technology. How do the product should do what they're supposed to do? And then they decide what are the things to be provided, what are the features to be provided in the product. And then they design the products. And then demonstrate is basically implementing the concepts and then delivering the product. And then they ensure that the customers are delighted with their product. So this is the requirement of any company. They want to delight their customers with the product. And to delight the customer, they need to provide the features which the customers definitely want and the customers may like to have or may expect, or some features which the customers don't even expect. So you provide more features than what the customer can expect, then the customers will be delighted. So that is the way how Xerox Corporation develops their product and sell in the market. So each stage, you'll be having gates in each stages. So there will be different gates. The strategy will be evaluated, and then it will go to the next stage, then it will go to the market and delight the customer. So you have many stages and gates, and at the end of the final gate, you have a product which goes to the customer. Okay. What's your roll number? Now let us take another example of, so this is the example for stage gate process. The next example, what is the other product development process? One is stage gate, spiral. So who uses spiral gate? Software company. So let us see how the Microsoft Corporation developed their products. Okay, so they actually have three stages, planning, coding, and stabilization. So this will be one cycle. And then again, it will go to one more cycle where again they will do the planning, coding, stabilization. It keep on happening like this, and it will go through multiple stage gate process, and finally they will release the product, and that is the spiral design process followed by Microsoft Corporation. So this way you will see any company you take, any manufacturer you take, you will see that they follow a process which will be either a stage gate process or a spiral design process. Of course, the names they give, the nomenclature may be slightly different, but all the companies will be having stages and gates to ensure that the product is really worth taking forward and customers will be happy to use the product. So that is the way how companies develop the product. Got it? Any questions? Okay. We talked about reverse engineering in one of the classes, and I told you that reverse engineering is basically to ensure that if some products are not meeting the expectations of the customer or the customers are not happy, then we try to redesign the product by looking at the product, what is there inside the product, and then try to develop just a new product. So that is basically known as reverse engineering. It's also a process of developing products. And sometimes we use this for learning product development. So basically, to learn the product development, we use the reverse engineering. The reason is that a concrete understanding of how products are developed helps you to get an idea how to make a good product. So we need to have some concrete experience in order to develop a new product. So that is what we are actually trying to do in the lab class, for you to get some concrete knowledge or experience of real products, and then you can look at the product and then see how this product can be improved, or how they are actually developing this product and how it can be improved. So that is why we use reverse engineering here, but reverse engineering is used by many companies to develop products. But what we are looking at is to see how reverse engineering can be used for learning product design. So this is what we are trying to do here. So starting with an existing product in the marketplace and redesigning it for some perceived market defects is known as reverse engineering. That is, you have a product. So I have a product like this, and I have some problem with this. Then I'll try to see, can I develop this product as a better one? So I'll try to understand what is happening inside. I'll open this, try to understand all the things, and then I'll find that, okay, this particular button is not properly placed, or it is actually creating a problem. So can I redo these buttons and then make it as a new product? So that is basically the reverse engineering. So I'll do all the understand all this happening inside, and then try to redesign it, and this is known as reverse engineering. So we existing products, we try to modify by some process, some methods, and we call it as reverse engineering and redesign. We call it as reverse engineering and redesign process. Of course, in this course, we will not be doing a redesign of the existing product, but we will try to understand what is happening inside each product, and then try to get an idea how they are actually develop the product, and what this product do in order to meet the customer's requirements. That is what the purpose of reverse engineering. So the reverse engineering entails the prediction of what a product should do, followed by modeling, analysis, dissection and experimentation of its actual performance. So we try to understand what the product is supposed to do and then try to understand how it is being done and then do some actual dissection of the products and then experimentation of its actual performance and then do a redesign to make it as a better product. That is the reverse engineering and redesign process of many industries follow this. Many industries will try to reverse engineer the products existing in the market to overcome some of the perceived difficulties or some shortcomings of the product and get a new product. So that is basically known as the reverse engineering and redesign process. So for us, what is the importance of reverse engineering? See, we are not going to redesign the existing product for this class, but why are we doing reverse engineering? Why are we doing this kind of exercises to understand the product? So last lab class, you did a dissection of a product. How many of you participated in the dissection? All of you? Or somebody just watched it? Okay. So did you learn something from that? Or it was a first time that you were doing a dissection? How many of you were doing it for the first time, opening a product? Okay, few of you, yeah. So now if you do this for multiple times, you will get a lot of information about how products work, how each product is providing an output. When you provide electricity, you are getting an output at the end of the product. So what is happening in between? What are the things that happen in between? And how the designer make it possible to happen is understood through product dissection exercises. So reverse engineering basically follow this principle for learning purpose. So there is something called a Kolb's model of learning. It says that the best way to learn things is basically to experience. So the moment you experience things, you know what is needed for doing that. So you'll be getting the best experience or best learning through experience. So the Kolb's learning model basically tells you that every learning starts with a concrete experience. How many times somebody tells you how to swim, you will learn only when you do experience the swimming, right? Similarly, driving, you can tell 100 hours of theory about driving, but the moment you start experiencing it, then only you start learning the drive. So design is also like that. You need to have some kind of concrete experience to start with the learning process. So reverse engineering basically tells you that the grounding in a current product helps nurture our interest for understanding the way things work and for making devices work better. That is the whole idea. So if you know the current product and how it works, that only will help you to design a better product. If you don't know how this works, you will never be able to redesign or improve the product. So the grounding in a current product helps a designer to design a better product. So that is the whole idea of reverse engineering and learning through experience. So the Kolb's model takes like that. You start with a concrete experience. That is, you want to learn something, you get an experience of that. So if you want to design a product, you experience how the product works. So open up the product, understand each part, what is the role of each part in a product, and what is the size, dimensions, what it actually does, how is it being assembled. All those things you understand, and then do the reflective observation. Why is it doing something? What is it, what makes it to do something? That is basically the reflective observation. Discussions. You discuss this product with your peers or your teaching assistants or the technicians. Discuss with them why is it needed, why a particular gear is provided, or why a belt drive is there, or why a particular component is assembled in two parts or three parts. So all those things you question, and then you will understand why and what of the products. So once you know why it works and what it makes to work, then you start how to improve it, or how about doing something different, or how to make a new conceptualization, abstract hypothesis and conceptualization. So now you know very well about what is happening. Now you start thinking of how to improve it. What can be done to make this product better, and then start working on it, and then go, what if you try to change something and then see what happens to the in the product. That is what if for active experimentation. So you start experimenting with the new designs or the new concepts, and then get the experience. So that actually completes the cycle of redesign process, reverse engineering and redesign process. So you will be doing these three parts: the concrete experience, reflective observation, and to some extent a conceptualization on how to improve the product. So during the lab, you are expected to do these three parts and then get a good idea of the existing product, so that you can be a good designer, or you can think of redesigning the product. So that is the whole idea of having the lab session on reverse engineering. Okay, any questions? All right. So whenever you do the lab exercise, whenever you try to prepare a report, keep these things in mind. The whole purpose of doing this, why are we doing this? We are doing this to get a good experience of what is happening in the product. Okay, that is the concrete experience, and to understand why and what makes this product possible, or why is it so, and what makes it to do something which you expect it to do, or you expect why is it not doing something which you want to do. So understanding this why and what helps you to clearly tell what is good about the product and what is bad about the product. So when you write the reports, try to answer these questions: what is good, what is bad, and why is it doing, what is it doing, and then see how can we improve upon it. Conceptualization, it will take some more time for you to come up with new ideas and concepts to make it better, but the ultimate aim is to see how do you improve an existing product. That is why if you open up an iron box, you should try to find out what is good and what is bad about it, and how to make it a better iron box. Then you are becoming a good designer. All right. Okay. So the learning cycle, okay, that's I already mentioned to you. Okay. It begins with concrete experience, proceeds with reflective observation and conceptualization, and ends before restarting with active experimentation. That is to make it and then try and experiment with the new products. So that is basically the Cobb's model of learning, which we are following in order to make sure that you understand the products in a much better way. So this is the summary of the reverse engineering. You investigate prediction and hypothesis, concrete experience from function and form, and that becomes the reverse engineering, and then you design the new product, then it becomes modeling analysis and redesign. So redesign can actually happen through adaptive design, original design, or parametric design. So these are the three methods by which you can design: original design, adaptive design, and changing the parameters. So any one of these can be used to redesign the products. That is reverse engineering and redesign methodology. Okay, so we start with reverse engineering, understand the market for current products, making intelligent estimates of what the functional model ought to be, and dissect the products, and then develop a redesign. So we saw that how do we actually design the new product using methods, or understanding the market and then developing a redesign. So we can actually summarize this in these three. That is reverse engineering, develop a redesign, and implement a concept. That is the reverse engineering stages. First, you do a reverse engineering of the existing product, select a product, develop a new vision for developing the product, customer need analysis, market opportunity analysis, and then functional modeling, competitive analysis, product architecture development, and then finally implementing a concept. So that is the reverse engineering and redesigning product development process. The new product development process we saw, instead of reverse engineer, we will be having a, what will be this stage in the new product development? There are two things. One is new product development, the other one is reverse engineering and redesign. New, completely new product development, you develop a vision and then develop a concept and then implement a concept. So this, instead of this, you will be having a reverse engineering, then develop a redesign and implement a concept. So these are the three stages that you will be having in the reverse engineering process. Okay, so let me summarize what we discussed in the last 3-4 classes. So we briefly talked about objective of engineering design, and then we talked about the type of design and redesign. So what are the types of design we discussed? Pardon? Original design, adaptive design, variant design, or sometimes called just parametric design also, variant design or parametric design. And then we talked about two stages or two product development process, that is gate process, stage gate process and spiral model process, right? And all of you know what is stage gate and what is spiral model, right? Okay. And then we talked about what are the different stages in product development. So we know that this is stage gate. And in stage gate process, there are multiple stages. So let us, before we start this, okay, I'll start this in the next class, how do you actually start a vision. But let us discuss some general things about designer. If you take any design problem, or you take designer as a problem solver, so any design problem has got three stages or three components, I can say, that you have an undesirable initial stage. You start with an undesirable initial stage. Oh, this is not working the way I want. That is my undesirable initial stage. Any product design problem you take, you will see that, okay, my cycle is not giving me the speed as I want. That is your undesirable initial stage. Or I need to pedal all the way from my hostel to the class. That is my undesirable initial stage. So you are not happy with something, or you feel something is not good, or something is not working the way you want, and that becomes your undesirable initial stage in the product development. And then you have a desirable goal stage. You know that, okay, I don't want to put any effort. I want to reach my classroom from the hostel without much effort, or any other issues you face. Okay. Somebody will say, okay, I will sweat a lot by coming from hostel to classroom. That is your undesirable initial stage. What do you want? You don't want to get sweat at all. Okay. So no sweating. That is your desirable initial stage, a desirable goal stage. So you have an initial state which is very much unfavorable, and you have a very desirable goal state also. Now, as a designer, your job is basically to move from here to here. You want to convert this undesirable stage to a goal stage. For every designer, every problem solver, that is what needed. The whole question is, how do we actually reach there? Because there will be a lot of roadblocks and impediments in achieving the goal. There will be a lot of difficulties in converting that undesirable goal to a desirable, and undesirable initial state to a desirable goal. So the moment you actually solve this and you try to overcome these things, then you are becoming a designer. You are actually getting a new product. So every designer is basically a problem solver. He is trying to solve a problem which he saw, and how he solves depends on how creative and how imaginative he is in removing the challenges. Okay, so that is where actually the designer comes as a problem solver. So when I say I have a problem with the projector, I know what is the problem, I know the undesirable initial states, I know what is the required state also. Okay, I don't want to connect my laptop to the system. The moment I switch on my laptop and press a button, it should get connected. I don't care how it happens. So I have an initial stage which is undesirable. I have a goal stage which is desirable. Now the question is, how do I reach there? How can I remove this cable between this projector and the laptop? If I can solve that, then I am getting a new product, right? So as a designer, what I will see, I will look at, okay, what is happening in this cable and is there another way to connect from here to there without using a cable? That is my challenge. So I have many option technologies are available. Now I will try to work on it and come up with a solution where the cable can be removed, then I am getting a new product. So I am solving a problem by overcoming the issues in having my goal state achieved. That is the problem solver. So every designer is a problem solver. So if you are ready to solve problem, then only you can become a good designer. But what are the good characteristics of a problem solver? What qualities you should have in order to become a good problem solver? What are the qualities? Pardon? Persistence. Yeah, good. Persistence. What is persistence? I will not stop, right? Whatever happens, I will keep on working on it till I reach my goal. What else? Failures. Patience. Okay, yeah, sometimes. Patience. Okay, correct. Next. What else? Okay, this I come back. Okay, of course. So, acceptance of failures, that is one thing. Then you say continuity and flexibility. That is basically the persistence, patience, everything comes under this one. You have to continue to work on it. And then estimating, okay, other things are basically recognizing the dependencies. I mean, you should be in a position to understand what depends on other. So, what is the dependency between two factors? There may be multiple factors, how they are interrelated, how this interrelationship can actually lead to better design. So that is, these are basically recognizing the dependencies, estimating importance and urgency, what is most important, what is to be solved first, that is the estimating importance and urgency and of course the decision making behavior which actually follows all these things. I mean, how do you make a good decision about something? Yeah, there may be multiple options, you don't know which one is good. So you should be able to recognize the dependencies, you should be understand the importance and urgency, continuity and flexibility, acceptance of failures. And of course, this becomes very critical in becoming solving the problem creatively. Okay. So you need to be intelligent and creative in order to solve the problem. So as a designer, you try to see whether some simple problems can be solved. Look around you and then see what are the simple problems you can see to solve. Okay, you may be working on it. So for example, very simple problems. So this lady who is working on this device, you know what is this? Pardon? Hand spinning machine, right? Yeah, so now, is there any problem with this machine? Do you think there is an undesirable initial state in this? And you know what is this? Pulley, right? For getting water from the well. People use it in villages. Do you think there is any problem with this kind of devices in rural places? I know most of you must have seen this. So this problem is that she has to stretch her hand to both sides. So this has to be controlled and this has to be controlled. She has to spin this and then control this side. So there is a lot of effort needed in doing this work. Can you make it a simple one? Can you make it as a most simple one where actually her effort can actually come down? So the desired initial state is that she need not have to stretch her body or put so much of effort in solving this, I mean doing this work. Similarly, here also you have lot of efforts needed to get the water. So is there a way to modify this to make a better design? And these are the things which you can see everyday life where people can actually solve problems. So whenever you see such problems, see whether as a designer you are able to contribute this in a better way, or you can actually contribute in improving the design as a designer. So now, hereafter, you all, whenever you see this kind of things, think about what way you can actually solve the problem. So take everything as a problem, and as a designer, you are solving the design problem. Okay, so to understand this, let us look at what is your individual characteristics as a designer or as an individual, because all of you will be having some special characteristics or special capabilities. Okay. So we can actually classify people based on few characteristics and then see how do they behave in a particular situation. So if you give a problem to a person, what will be the way in which he tried to solve the problem? Right? Suppose somebody asks you, okay, go to T Nagar. What will you do? Somebody says, okay, can you go to T Nagar? You know T Nagar, right? All of you? Oh, you don't know, sorry. Okay. So somebody says, okay, go to airport. What will you do? Immediately start from home, right? Do you do that? Or you try to find out where is airport? What are the ways in which you can reach airport? Is there a bus or is there a taxi or what is the best way to reach? And what time is the best time to go there? What time is the bad time to go there? So there are many things. Somebody will immediately start, okay, oh, you want me to go to airport? Let me start. And then he will reach the gate and then think about, okay, oh, now I have reached the gate. Should I take a bus or a taxi? Then he will start thinking about it. And then he'll go take a bus. Then he does not know where to get down. So he'll call his friend, oh, where should I get down? Then he get down that place. Then he saw how, from where, how to go to the airport. So there are people in thinking in different ways and working in different styles. So when you work as a group or as a team, you will see that people work not, don't work in the same way as you wish. So it is good to know what is your personal working style. Are you a person who go into the details and plan everything and then go? Or you are a person you just jump into it and then see, oh, let me see what will happen. Okay. So to do that, let us do a simple exercise. I think last time I gave you a form. How many of you have that form with you? Okay, please take out that form. And if you don't have the form also, no worry, no worries. I'll tell you what to do. Okay. So in that form, some instructions are given. I'll give you the same instruction here also, so you don't need to worry even if you don't have it. So I'll try to give your personality type in four letters. So you can actually identify four letters based on your type of character. So let me see the first one. Okay, let me finish it. So this is known as Myers-Briggs Type Indicator or MBTI. That is, what type of a person you are. That is the type indicator. Are you a person with very detailed planning, or you are a good person as a marketing expert, or you are good in making something hands-on? These are all the things which you can actually identify. So this is known as Myers-Briggs type indicator, as measurement indicator of how people behave and contribute in work environments. So as a designer, how will you be contributing? So please go through this. You can actually be a person by E or I based on how you are energized. What gives you energy? For some people, energy gets when they talk to their friends. When they are in a group, they are very energetic. When you leave them alone, they are very depressed. They cannot work. For some people, living alone is the best way to energize them. In a group, they feel very uncomfortable. They cannot do things when they are in a big group. That kind of people are there. That is basically how a person is energized. Extraversion versus introversion. What a person pays attention to, his sensory feelings or his own intuition. Sensory feelings are what you see, what you hear, that becomes important for him. For others, what you hear is not important, but what you think, what you know about that is more important than sensory person. That is basically sensory versus intuition, S versus N. And how a person decides, what way you decide on things, you based on your thinking or based on your feeling. I'll explain this later, what actually you mean by these things. And what kind of outlook on life a person adopts, judgment versus perception. Okay, so the point is that you cannot be E or I. For each category type, a person is assumed to have an intrinsic preference for one of each pair over the other. That is, you can be a E or I. You cannot be in between. Though you may say that, okay, I am half this, but there is a clear difference that you can be either a E or I. Similarly, you can be S or N, or T or F, J or P. So you choose one letter from each one of these, that gives you a personality type or your character type. Okay, don't choose now. I'll tell you when to choose. So let us move to that one. Okay, just read this extrovert versus introverted person. Extroverted person will act first, think later. Go to airport, he will start to airport. He will not ask, why are you going, where are you, when should I go? Start, and then only he will start thinking about it. Feel deprived when cut off from the interaction with the outside world. He wants always people around him. He wants always to be with people. He does not like to be alone. He cannot work alone. That kind of people are E. Usually open and motivated by outside world of people. Enjoy wide variety and change in people relationship. He wants to have a lot of changes in the people relationship. Variety of people, all kinds of friends will be there. From all walks of life, he will be having friends. That kind of a person is basically an extroverted person. The other one is introverted. Think, reflect first and then act. If you ask him to go to airport, he will say, ah, okay. And why do you want to go? When do you want to go? What is the reason? He will ask you 100 questions. And if he is convinced, then only he will start. He will not start like this person. That is I. And regularly require an amount of private time. So he does not like to be always in the crowd. He needs his own time to work, think. That is basically private time. Motivated internally, mind is sometimes so active, close to outside world. So he gets energy from himself. He wants time to think about himself, think about things. He doesn't want others to disturb him so that he will get energy from himself. So that kind of, and he prefer one-to-one communication and relationship, very specific relationship, specific communication, not like a very general communication. So that is basically the one-to-one communication. So now you can write whether you are E or I. Okay, you cannot be E and I, can be either E or I. In between. No, but there is very, the understanding is that you have a basic characteristics. Okay, sometimes you may be very E, some out of 100 times, maybe 10 times you behave like an E, but 90 times you are behaving like an I, then you are an I. That is the understanding. Not that always you'll be like that. So you have a specific preference for E or I. Wrote it? Okay, please write which one. We'll try to finish it fast. The other one is sensing and intuition. So sensing, mentally live in the now, attending to present opportunities, using common sense and creating. So he'll look at the current things, and based on current things, he'll decide what is to be done. Intuitive person, he'll look at, okay, if I do this, what will happen next time? And what are the implications of all these things? All these are decided using N. So that is S or N. So he looks at patterns, context, and connections. So he look at what happened many times, what is the context in which it happened. All those things will be analyzed by an N person, intuitive person, but he won't look at that one. He will look, okay, what happened, what is the current thing, just take a decision. So that is basically a sensing person and intuitive person. So you decide whether you are a S or N. And the next one is judging versus perceiving. Oh, sorry, thinking versus feeling. So thinking person will look for facts and logic. He don't look by the feelings of others. He will look at, if I have to say no to a person, I will say no to him whether he likes it or not. I don't care. That is the thinking person. He thinks based on his the information and facts and logic. If somebody is wrong, he will say you are wrong. Okay, doesn't care whether he likes or not. That kind of person is a thinking person. This person is feeling, very sensitive to people's needs. Oh, if I tell him, what will he feel? Let me don't tell him the truth. Let me be very nice to this person. Though he knows that it is wrong, he will be still very nice to people, thinking that, okay, feeling is more important than thinking. So that is the thinking versus feeling type. And the last one is judging versus perceiving characteristics. So judging person will plan many of the details in advance before moving into action. So he'll be very detailed person. He will not jump into the solution. He'll say, okay, if I have to do this, I need to understand this. Then only I will go to a decision. That is the judging characteristics. Perceiving characteristics directly jump into the action. Okay. If you say that, okay, go to airport, he will start with his cycle. He will not ask for any questions. He will start into action. Then on the way, he will start planning. That is basically the perceiving characteristics. So that is the main difference. So focus on task-related action, complete meaningful segments, work best and avoid stress. If you have to submit an assignment tomorrow, he will complete the assignment 2 days back. Okay. That is the kind of judging person. So all of you will be P, right? Report you start on the previous night only, no? Or the early morning or in the previous class. Okay, so people will be different. So don't look at one instance. Look at as a overall, what is your characteristics, whether J or P. Completed? So what is your 4-letter words? All the 4. So you have to say from the first E or I, you decide E or I, S or N, T or F, J or P. So you'll be getting like I, S, T, J, E, F, like that. Got it? How many I, S, T, J's are there? I, S, T, J. No. What is your? Yes? Okay. So let me see what, just 2 minutes. So like, for example, now you look at, if a person is ISTJ. Anybody ISTJ? Nobody. You are there. Okay, so what is the characteristic of this person? You give him a task to complete in 12 hours. Okay? So you say that you have 12 hours to complete this task and give the task to him. So he will spend almost 5 hours understanding the problem. Okay, he will look into the problem, very detailed, all the analysis he will do. And then, once he understood the problem, he will get the solution within an hour. He can actually solve the problem within an hour because he has spent a lot of time understanding the whole problem, he solves it. And then once he had the solution, he will not go to implement the solution. He will try to analyze the solution, look all angles of the solution to see whether there is a problem, chance of failure. He will spend a long time. He'll spend a long time to analyze the solution. And once he analyzes solution, he will implement the solution. That much is the distribution, how he actually do the work. Very detailed person, very analytical. He wants to analyze everything. But once he understood, he'll be actually able to solve the problem with very short period. That is ISTJ. And in contrast, if you take an INFJ, anybody INFJ? You're INFJ. Okay. So this person, you give a problem. Oh, okay. This is the problem. I got a solution. I mean, he'll not think too much. He'll start solving the problem. And since he has not understood the problem very well, he takes a long time to solve it because many solutions will be wrong. And then after solution, he will start analyzing it for a long time and then implement it for a long time. So that is the way how this person works. He will not worry about the problem per se. He'll start solving the problem. And same way, you can actually see all these people, different ways how the people work. ESFP, INTP, etc. So if you want to know more, you can actually refer to this MBTI characteristics. And you know what will be the way you will be working in a group, what will be the most feasible characteristics you have. Okay. So I'll stop here. If you have any questions, you can meet me later about this. But this is just to tell you the people will be having different characteristics, different ways of working. You should understand the way how people work. Thank you.